Hey guys, welcome back to Home Built, and this week it's getting down to crunch time. We've got 2 weeks left until World Time Attack, when I am going to be publicly debuting the Alfarrari. So we have a few more things to go in it, and then I'm going to continue trying to work towards what I need to do to get this thing started. Let's get into it. All right, guys, welcome back. And those watching last week will have seen that I finally got the bonnet on the car, but it didn't all go as smoothly as I hoped it would. There was a couple of issues, and I'll run you through that. There were tons of suggestions in the comments, and I appreciate it. And I'll show you why they basically none of them can work. Let's go around that now and cover that off. All right, so there were a heap of comments saying that I should put a bulge in the Perspex cover. That is not going to work because it's not the middle where it's touching. It's these ends here. So as I close this bonnet down, you can see how close it gets. And it's actually probably that side is the worst because of the shape of this. This bank sits slightly forward to this one. So it's touching down the ends here. It is almost just touching on the top of the horse there, but I can probably remove that spacer. There's not that big of an issue there. The bulge is not going to help me because it's at these ends. That's the part that's actually touching, so that's not going to help. Another suggestion was moving the engine back. I can't do that for multitudes of reasons. Basically, the issue with this engine is there is a 10 mil gap pretty much. All I have is a 10 mil gap everywhere around this car. I can get the oil filter off where it is there, but only just. It's really hard to see there, but there is space. I went over the issues with oil relocation kits and stuff like that in previous videos. It's been well covered, but yes, I can't move the engine back. Moving the engine down is also not a possibility. If we have a look here, there is barely 10 millimeters as it is from the base of the engine up. So that's not going to work either. So unfortunately, that's a no. There were other options, as I've mentioned. I already cut the runners down 70 mil. That was the absolute lowest I could get them to be able to get fuel rails on. There is water lines underneath. There's a whole bunch of stuff that I need to get to underneath. There is no way to cut that down anymore. I did the maximum I could possibly get and still have everything functioning underneath it like it needs to. So that's why I came up with the only option is to actually just cut a section out of these. There is quite a rib there that I can probably, like, a lot of it could potentially just be ground down. So if I grind this down, I will probably put a flat panel in there to taper it off, and it'll be flattened, but then it'll curve off on the edges. It's not just going to be a flat, like, ugly piece. I will make it blend and fit the profile. So yeah, I really don't think it's going to be a huge issue. I think that is, after lots of contemplating, that's the easiest option. I mean, I think the main reason it's actually higher is because I've just added all the gaskets, and then with the thickness of the Lexan, what I might also do is I'll probably swap out this piece of Lexan for a slightly thinner piece. This is about 6 mil. I think I've got some 3 or 4 mil there, and it does have a curve to it, so it's not going to be too sort of wobbly and floppy. It should hopefully hold its shape. So there's options there, but yeah, that is something for later, because I can start this as it is with the bonnet up. It's just before it's actually fully done and drivable, that's when I need to have this part done, so that can come later. So, moving forward. All right, next up is I need to connect up my dry sump oil tank, which is under here, over through to the engine. Now, I've already made the lines and everything, but just realizing another thing is the wheel arch flare just foul. So I'm going to have to clearance that out, and I have to actually take this off, and I'll clearance it once the oil line's in. So even though I've already mounted it on, I need to unbolt the flare, take it off, clearance the bottom of it where I need to clearance it, and then connect up the oil line. It's all little bits and pieces, all these fiddly little things that take time. All right, so my dry sump tank is here. I've got my lower hose, and basically the oil goes out of the engine through the oil cooler, comes around to the front and into the oil tank, and then goes from this back into the engine again. So I've got a filter, just an inline filter that I'm running just in the end of the oil tank, just for a bit of peace of mind, because there's a long way from the filter through all the stuff to get to here, particularly because this is the first time it's run. I may remove it later. I'm just worried that if that clogs up, then the engine doesn't get any oil and there's no pressure feed going to here. This is all gravity fed back into the bottom of the engine, and we've got the head pressure of the whole tank pushing it down, but it's still something I'm concerned about, the engine running out of oil, and I will potentially, once it's been running for a while, remove that. I'll just see how I feel. I'm definitely going to pull it out after a little bit of running and give it a clean, do an oil change, and just make sure it's all good. But let's mount this oil line back up and keep going. All right, so the oil return line is connected up. So this is essentially similar to how the factory set up the dry sump tank. The factory one was sitting on top of the Ferrari gearbox, and it just traveled through a gallery internally in the gearbox and then went through the bell housing into the engine. On my engine, I had to make, as part of the adapter plate design, the oil enters in and turns in and goes in through the adapter plate into the engine, and the dry sump pump is actually internal in the Ferrari engine. So there's no external pump like your traditional sort of muscle car dry sump setup where you're doing it aftermarket. This was all done by the factory. That's how Ferrari did it. Now I've got my bash plate that I made up that needs to go on over the top, but now I realize that some of the extra bracing I built put under the car is interfering, so we need to now clearance that so that this will fit, and then we can start fitting the guard again and so on and so forth. No, 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 no. No, 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 no. I am so frustrated right now. It is not funny. I've had lots of things going on in the background this morning, and I wasn't fully paying attention, and I was raising the car up and I didn't pay close attention to how high I lifted it up. You see where the car is, and you see there's a beam over the top, and I actually lifted the car up into the beam and creased the roof. After all that work, I am really, really frustrated. It's all repairable. It hasn't actually cracked the paint. I can possibly even get it paintless dent removed and get it pushed back up again. But, and can remove the window, get underneath the headliner, pop it up, paintless remove it, and just sort of press it back. I am so utterly furious right now. So much work, and it was so close, and it's just, there's no structural damage. It's only cosmetic. It's, I can see it's on the other side of the sort of the frame for the roof, although it might actually be double skin there. It might be a, it's staying that way for now. It's staying that way for the show. You can all see my moronity. I think I need to have a break. Calm down a bit. And come back. All right, so I've gone and had some lunch and I've calmed down a little bit, and I'm still really annoyed with myself for doing it, but it's not the end of the world. It could potentially be paintless dent removed, so that's something that I will look into. It may require removing the rear window. At least it didn't hit the rear window and break the rear window. The trim and everything is all fine. It's just in, it's above that, so it's not the end of the world, but still annoying. Anyway, moving on. All right, and my stone guard is all in there installed. I am gonna have to take it off again when I put in the master cylinders and stuff for the brakes, because that all is one piece covering up all that. But just making sure that's in place so I can start trimming out that front guard. So a lot of gradual trimming, and I've managed to trim out the bottom of the flare. I knew I was going to have to, just it's just the nature of that, the way the dry sump works. There's just no room in this car, as I've gone over many, many times. But that's a nice big solid steel bash plate there for the dry sump tank. So that's nice and tidy. So we can now move on to something else. All right, so the next thing I need to do is connect up my alternator. Now, the guys at Wasp Performance built this alternator for me and asked me what I wanted. And this is just a, basically a single wire alternator. So meaning there's the main power wire that goes in here, and into the plug section, there's one wire which goes to the alternator light on the dash, and that's what energizes the alternator. Just also wanted to mention, there were a couple of people concerned about my grounding cable going into the sump of the bottom of the engine, that it's separated by a gasket. I am not concerned about that in any way. There's about 30 bolts going through to hold it on, to connect it to the top of the engine. And the main thing that would need the power, or the grounding anyway, would be the alternator, which is mounted to the same thing. So I'm not concerned about this grounding cable at all. The only other thing would be injectors, which don't take very much at all, easily grounded through these 30 bolts. So I've zero concerns about that. So let's start making up some alternator wiring. Alright, so I have to order myself some more heat shrink for these terminals. I've just used some electrical tape for the time being, but I have my connection to my alternator grommeted through, and I have some Raceworks heat shield over the cables. It also plugs into the back of the alternator, and I now need to make up some tabs to sort of hold this in place, because I can't have this cable flopping around all over the place. It flows around and goes up next to the gearbox. It does come close-ish to the exhaust, so obviously I want to keep that tucked well out of the way. So I've got to make up some tabs that I can connect cable ties to hold these cables in the right spot. All right, so now that the alternator is wired in on the alternator end, I need to do the last little bit. So when I ordered the alternator from Wasp Performance, basically I got a one wire alternator. So how it works, you've only wire you've got in it, well, you sort of have two wires. You have the main cable, which is the charging cable, which obviously goes from the alternator to the starter motor, and the starter motor is also connected straight to the battery, so that's your charging. You then have one other wire which goes to your alternator light on the dash, and it needs to be connected to that alternator light on the dash for it to actually energize the alternator for the alternator work. If it's not connected, the alternator won't work. So I am going to be using the factory dash, or at least bits and pieces of it. And the alternator light is here. So I had a look on the back of the dash, and it's a very crude circuit board. It's very easy to follow. I know that is my alternator light. So that corresponds with a pin here on this connector, and then it needs to be connected to the positive of the dash on this other connector. And the way I go through and make sure everything works is, I've mentioned this before, again, it's not sponsored, but this thing is fantastic. If you are doing any automotive electrical work, I highly recommend this. This is a power scanner. There is a link in the description to one if you want to have a look. Basically what this thing does, this can measure resistance, a whole bunch of stuff. Basically most of the things that a multimeter can do, but much simpler to use. And the other bonus is that out of this tip, you can test stuff, but you can also, just by pressing this toggle up, it sends positive out the end. And if you press it down, it sends negative out of the end. So you can just automatically test systems, and it does have a little circuit breaker on it as well. So if you've got a dead short somewhere, it will trip and you can find that. So this is what I'm going to use to test all of the electrical system on the car. So for example, I know my lights and I need to be testing there. Yeah, I can hear that. There's a circuit, and just by clicking, sorry about the noise, I can turn that light on. I know the alternator light works. So let's plug this in, and we can move on from the alternator and look at something more fun. Ah, this is something I have been waiting for quite some time now. I've been working in the background for probably almost 12 months with Titan Suspension, designing a brand new coilover adjustable height and damper suspension kit for the Alfa 105s. We've been doing a fair bit of work also with Tim at Zoo Autocraft, getting spring rates and damping and stuff like that all organized. And this is really, really some cool stuff. So I've got some custom spring sets for this car, but we've also got some other spring rates for regular sort of street driving and things like that. So I'll put a link in the description to Titan, and you can go and have a look at their gear. I am very, very excited to get this in the car. I've already driven in Tim's car with this suspension, and it's really good. I like having the adjustment. I can now corner balance the car, and particularly on the Alfarrari, because I'm heavier, I get to play around with spring rates, obviously, I haven't driven the car yet. We may need to go up or down in spring rates, but they've got spring rates in a bunch of different sizes. So it's easy enough to just get the different springs and swap them in and out to get the suspension feeling just right on the road / track or whatever you're doing. So I am very, very happy with the look of this stuff. And it's, as I said, I've already used it, and it's good stuff. So It actually has a separate spring perch because of the way the suspension on the Alfa works. The front has a separate spring and shock, so the shocks are a separate shock to the spring, but there's a spring perch and everything in there. So let's go through now and fit up some suspension, and then hopefully we can get the Alfarrari down on its wheels under its own weight and being able to be at least moved around, which is going to be an absolute game changer. All right, so we have the rear shock is mounted into place. I had to reuse the old rubber bushings I had because I didn't order any more of them. And for some reason, there's actually a cap that sits on inside that the shock goes through. And I can only find one rear shock of my originals, and I don't have the other shock cap. So for the moment, I can only fit one of the rears. So hopefully I've pleaded with Tim at Zoo Autocrafter. Hopefully he has something around that he can help me out with. For the time being, we need to move on and start doing the fronts. So I didn't actually realize until after I finished this, but I've actually installed the top hat for this front spring upside down. So that will be something that I rectify next week and get the ride height looking just right. Alright, so I've got the front in, the shocks connected on, and it actually has an adjuster right here, so you can just reach in and adjust by hand. To get the spring in, the spring perch has an adjustment in it down in the bottom in there. I had to replace these bolts with long bolts to be able to tension the spring up, which is how you get the springs into the Alfa. That's just the way you need to do it. When you're undoing them, don't do it the way I did it when I first did it and undo these bolts, and just because this spring is under a lot of tension. The factory spring is under a lot of tension and is very, very dangerous. Yes, go back and watch my first or second video on this series and you'll actually see how dangerous that is. All right, this side is in and done. Tim has saved my butt again, because for some reason I've stripped the entire garage and I can only find three of my original shock absorbers, and I needed to get the factory cap off of the other rear. So this is basically the shock gets bolted through this, and this gets bolted down inside there's sort of some rear panels in the back seat area where this is gets bolted onto. He had this on his rotisserie, which he cut off of his rotisserie. This is how he mounts his cars on the rotisserie. So thank you again, Tim, for saving me again. I've got to clean up the welds and stuff, or he had it welded on, but that is going to help me out. So I need to do the other side, and then we should be able to put it on his wheels and see how I've got the heights. It could be all over the place. That needs some adjustment because it's sitting really high at the front and really low at the back. So there's obviously some adjusting that I need to do on that. But that is all the time I have this week. And next week is World Time Attack. So I basically have just next week, I have a couple of days to try and get this sorted out, so then I can chuck it on a trailer and take it to World Time Attack, for hopefully a bunch of you to come and join me and have a look at it and be able to sort of see it in the flesh. I still cannot believe that I wrecked the roof of the Alfarrari. I am so annoyed at myself for doing that. I've blocked it out the last few days, but it's just looking at it infuriates me again after doing all this work, and it could have been worse. It didn't smash the rear window. That would have been a nightmare, because trying to find another rear window would be very difficult. It's not the end of the world, but it just, I just didn't need it. So that is it for this week. There won't be any fun facts with Mrs. Jeff this week, because she's had some major dental surgery and has a mouthful of stitches and stuff. So she is not going to be here for this one. So yes, hopefully you enjoyed it. Do all the things. Join us on Patreon to watch videos ad-free a day before everybody else. And hopefully you'll join me next week at World Time Attack. All right, guys. See you next time. See ya. No, 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 no. No, 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 no.